I was born in this house in 1962, the youngest of four boys. I went to this school by bus. My mother was American. My father took us to see the Beatles in 1969. I grew up, I had my own kids, got married. Then, while working in this building in 2004, I suddenly experienced all the evil and horror in the world crowding in on me, and I started to shake uncontrollably. A year later, I was diagnosed with Parkinson's, divorced, and separated from my family. I went to live in the country. I went on voyages of self-discovery. But no matter where I went, I couldn't escape from me. Then, my then girlfriend introduced me to Susie Cream Cheese. Every now and then in your life, you may meet a person with whom you click, who understands you and enriches your life. Pamela Zarubica is one of those people, and she encouraged me to make this film. This is her story, and my story, and yours too.
Being on the bus to Venice Beach with Jim, soon to be the Lizard King, Morrison. I was the secretary at the Whiskey, and he came in the afternoon with a joint, which we smoked in the hallway. And when the day was done, he came for me. We got on a bus going to Venice Beach. My outfit in those days was baby blue Levi's, a little surfer t-shirt, the kind with a little pocket. And as I was sitting on the back of this bus, which was an unusual thing to do if you were in America, especially in Los Angeles, especially in Hollywood, taking a bus, I felt all this cold liquid on my body. I looked down and realized I was sitting in a pool of blood. And not just a little, a lot. So I'm like, oh my God, what am I gonna do? Got my little pea coat. So we get to Venice where we're going. And we have like hardly any money, but it goes into the wherever and gets me what I required. And I go into a service station and pick up my trousers and wash them all out. It's freezing cold. And then we go into Olivia's, otherwise known as the Soul Kitchen. Have a nice little bite to eat. And I think not many people can say they spent their first date with the Lizard King, having him buy them Tampax.
What's it all about? Come here, we walk around, smoke a few cigarettes, drink a few fizzy drinks, and then we're gone. Relationship with your bus driver or your barber or the person standing behind the till, you're missing the point. If your thing is yourself, self, and selfishness, you're never gonna know any real joy. Talk about happiness, talk about fulfillment. Go out there and find the people in the street. They're your friends.
It's a snowy day in London in 2010, and I'm on my way to see Pamela Zarubica, who grew up in Inglewood, Los Angeles, California, in the 1950s and 60s. She knew Frank Zappa, she knew Jim Morrison, she knew Lenny Bruce. It's a long way from sunny California to North London. On a snowy day. I do the last bit on foot.
Are you driving? Oh my God, you rode your bike. I suppose you want a woman for certain things. Now you can film me. Both the main roads are fine. Where did you say you got this camera?
In a second-hand store.
Trigger was a big horse, at least 17 hands, and he had known many riders. He was Mr. Stately's horse, kindest man I've ever known. A cowboy from Colorado, he drove a beaten old pickup truck, and he didn't believe in dentists. Always dressed in warm and faded denim, slick back hair, and cowboy hat. He was my mother's best friend. He taught me how to ride. They all loved and respected my mother, these amazing people of the earth. The gardener, Mr. Villalobos. They worked side by side planting trees. He did the really heavy work, and my mother did the rest. When I was 3 or 4, they put me on a horse and taught me how to ride English, but I hated it. I was much happier riding bareback. I could fly on the back of the horse. And Mr. Stately had these 2 small white horses, Golden and Flicka. He was the cowboy. I was definitely the Indian right from the start. We used to ride in those days across land so beautiful, uncluttered, with anything much except sand dunes, sky so blue, straight down to the ocean. Sometimes when we went over the big sand dunes, the horses would suddenly lie down, shake me off, and have a good roll around on their backs. I was taken off guard the first time it happened, Mr. Stately chuckling away. For the next time, I was prepared. He used to stretch us all the time, make us ride up high slopes, things that really scared me, things I thought I couldn't do, that we were following him and we would be left behind if we didn't. He had a gentle and good-natured way of setting our fears aside. He pushed us always. If we were trotting along, he'd make us take off in a gallop. If the horses were frisky, he'd put a saddle on and we held on tight while they romped and bucked. And when upon occasion we hit the ground unannounced, he'd check us over, dust us off, and back on we went, little legs still trembling in big old cowboy boots. He was the closest thing to a father I ever had, a true role model, so full of kindness and courage. That he loved my mother is obvious now. And when he died, so great was his capacity for love that his heart was twice its normal size. The saddle pals. We would all dress up in blue satin outfits, fancy white leather chaps with little blue hearts on, golden bridles, and ride in little local parades and horse shows. One time when we went to the Rose Bowl, I remember how hot it was waiting around all day long, satin shirts sticking to us. And then Queenie freaking out totally when we went through the tunnel. Mr. Stately's idea, if a horse was freaking out like from a train or a loud noise, was to bring him up closer. He was an old school and traditional cowboy with all that was entailed. But he had stamina and nothing spooked him. Not like me with a couple of tons of wild-eyed Palomino horse trembling and dancing underneath me as we negotiated that dark and intimidating tunnel. And then one day I was riding on the back of Trigger, my brother in the saddle, when something spooked him. He reared up and went over backwards, and we fell. My brother was thrown clear, but Trigger and I went over backwards onto his side, and he caught one of his legs under a nearby horse trailer, and I was trapped underneath him. My legs were wrapped around the back of him, one between him and the trailer. There was no one around. My brother had no choice but to run for help. We lay there together, alone and trapped. Fortunately, I was young and my bones were still soft. I felt this mighty weight on top of me, one with me, in fear and helplessness. We were together. And while I was no doubt in shock and a lot of pain myself, I was talking to him, comforting him. I lay there for a long time before many pairs of boots stood around me and worried faces looked down on me, worried that he would crush or trample me when they freed him. But somehow he came up gently and they were able to pull me free. The gentle beast was unharmed and allowed me to rise up with him. Thank you, Trigger, for overcoming your tremendous fear and allowing me to be pulled free of your hooves.
Hello, teenage America. My name is Susie Cream Cheese. I'm Susie Cream Cheese because I've never worn fake eyelashes in my whole life, and I never made it on the surfing set, and I never made it in the beatnik set, and I couldn't cut the groupie set either. And actually, I really fucked up in Europe. Now that I've done it all over and nobody else will accept me, I've come home to my mother's.
I was a child of the 60s, and I'm delighted to be a child of the 90s. There were people who would kill to have lived my life.
Pamela speelt een grote rol in het leven van Zappa tijdens de opname van Freak Out.
I've always been very reluctant about telling tales because everyone involved always liked to make it like I wasn't there. I had nothing to do with it or I had no part of it. And I walked into the trip and Phil Spector appeared. His little pea coat, the navy pea coat. Philip, as he likes to be called. And I laid eyes on him. I had no idea who he was. He was the oddest looking little creature. So vulnerable. Like some little wet weasel that someone had drug in. And I thought, no one could ever love him. And I did. And I still do. Doesn't matter what someone does. Love doesn't always go away. He knew that I wanted him when I didn't know who he was. And they all knew that. And that was the bond.
Pamela, she was living with Frank at the time. There were five girls living in the house with Frank up on Kirkwood Avenue, up in the Laurel Canyon. He had his little harem up there. And Gail was also one of the girls that was living up there. It just so happened that I don't know how Gail came out on top. It should have been Pam. Because I know that Frank really loved her a lot, man. She was a good girl. She's one of the nicest women in the world you'll ever meet. She just called me about 3 weeks ago out of the blue. She must have been getting vibes from me. She's a medium now. A psychic. That's what she does in England.
I'm moving outside. Okay, I'm letting go.
Why Goodhart?
My mother's name was Marjorie Louise Goodhart. And she was a very gentle individual compared to the very aggressive and horrible energy of my father. When I was growing up, there was never any sanctuary.
My father was an extremely powerful man. He was an honorary deputy sheriff, gun-toting. He was head of the Masonic Lodge and head of the Shriners. That's the one where they wear the funny hats. He was very involved in the Serbian Orthodox community, and everyone was afraid of him, including the sheriff's department and the police department.
I grew up in California in, you know, like, we're going back 60-odd years, right? So there were no, all that was there were orange groves and trees. And I grew up, I was raised by a cowboy named Mr. Stately, and we had horses, nothing fancy, and horses and cats and dogs and fishies. And like I'd go outside and like mice would come up to me and squirrels would come up to me and my parents would go, oh my God, that squirrel's gonna bite you. And I was like, what? There's a squirrel in my pocket. Animals play a huge role in my evolution as a healer and medium. And I think that people tend to undervalue the true role of animals on the planet. Animals are not lesser souls. They have souls. They exist on the other side. They bring far more than tremendous comfort into our lives. Animals come to the planet to love and to heal. But I also believe that animals free us to be able to love unconditionally in a way that we are very, very often frightened to give to each other, sad though it may be. And we love our animals in that unconditional way. And your heart is then opened. And I think that there's a lot to learn from, you know, that basic love for a creature. Would that we felt safe enough and open enough to give that love to each other. That communication and that acceptance was something that I felt that I never felt from people. I was always weird, I was always different, and proud to be. I've been a healer all my life, apparently, because whenever I've put my hands on people, I always go, wow, that feels really good. And I came to the world of healing through the animal kingdom. I came to the world of the natural medicines that I employ through the animal kingdom.
My name is Khalil Boumerdassi, and I'm from Algeria, North Africa.
Hello, good morning, sir. How are you?
That's how we see the world getting by from this window every day. Seeing the world going by.
Gotta give it your an energy.
Oh my God.
Me, you know, I definitely know that there are angels, and I definitely am absolutely certain that there is a God, that God is love and loving energy, you know. What we feel for each other, you know, in a very kind way.
Maybe we are living half life. We are not living a full life. And I will explain to you how it works. You see these cars, they are passing by, or anybody, a human passing by. How we look, we just look at things from one angle. Where we are directing. We are not looking on the left, on the right, on the top, on the bottom. That makes sense. What we are missing, what we see, we all missing most of it to half of it. We're supposed to care about each other. Even drunk man, you should care about him. Oh, he's drunk, so what, big deal. But if we keep away from each other, we are going nowhere. We are going nowhere.
That window is not going to block out someone's energy. And, oh, you can't pick up their energy if they're down the road in Kilburn? Do you think miles have anything to do with energy? It's, wake up, folks, it's all energy. And the mediumship is, as I said, not something that I would have chosen, and yet an extraordinary thing to have been chosen. One is ultimately no more than a channel for energy, which is coming through. We all have our body, and then we have an outer body, an outer body, an outer body. Auras, people have heard of auras. I'm able to move from my heavier state into my lighter state quite easily, apparently. So I'm able to pick up energy. It can be wearing when you can see potential outcomes and perhaps help people in a certain way, and yet they're unwilling. You could hand them the keys, you know, but you can't pick them up and put them in the lock. People have choices. You know, I see you. I see the cameraman. I see people on the street. Fearing becoming older. Oh, when you turn 50, oh, it's all over, it's all over. Why? Because somebody told you something? You know, the age thing. Forget the age thing. You limit yourself totally. Life is so magical, so full of synchronicity, the everyday event. So we fear aging and we fear death. And we live our whole lives by the fact that we fear aging, because aging brings us closer to death. Never mind the big wave could come and drop on your head right now, and you wouldn't have a choice. I know what I have been told in messages that I have heard. There is no death. What if we all knew it? What if we all just woke up? There's no death. It doesn't exist. It goes on. Where do you think the love goes? And if I had one message for the world at large, you get straight back what you give out.
To introduce myself, my name's Betty, and I'd like to let you know how I met Pam and how she helped me. A couple of years ago, I was walking across this cemetery with my dog using a walking stick, and I came across Pam, who I had met occasionally, not really much to speak to, but we nodded on occasions, and she asked me, "What's up, babe?" And I said, "Well, actually, Pam, I've had trouble with a nerve in my leg. I had been to acupuncture and seen an osteopath, and she said to me, would you mind if I try to help you?" And I said, I was a bit wary at first because I hadn't really known Pam that well, and she said I'd have to put her hand on my leg, and I thought, well, I'm not really into that sort of thing with strange women, but she said it won't hurt me or anything like that. So I thought, well, I was in such pain, I wanted to try and get rid of it. So Pam put her hands on my leg, just like this, where the pain was. And I did at first felt a bit foolish. I thought, I hope nobody comes along and sees us like this. So anyway, I'm laughing now, but at the time it wasn't funny because I was in a lot of pain. And then all of a sudden I began to feel some heat generate on my leg. And I thought, uh-oh, what's going on here? Because I'm not really one of those people that believe in sort of healing and things like that. I'm very sceptical, you know, I don't really believe in it. But I did feel this heat sensation going down my leg. So Pam kept her hands there for about 5-10 minutes. And she said, I can feel it. And so I said, so can I. And I thought, oh. And so that was that. And then I went home, I was still using the stick, and a few hours later, my leg began to feel a lot better. And my beliefs in healing was sort of knocked out of the water, because I thought, perhaps there is something in this after all. And it did happen right here on this bench, where I'm sitting now today. As you can see, without a stick.
She's called You Fucker. I had a really rough night. Not like in the old days when I might, as I told young Tobias, reflecting on his birthday, wake up face down in my own vomit, but the kind where my body, for reasons of its own, decides to do weird things like pulling and twisting for no understandable reason in places that make it really hard, in this case impossible, to lie comfortably in any direction. My body, once paralyzed, is, like myself, weird and challenged. Not as much as, say, Ian Dury, but I can definitely relate. I do my best to stand up straight, but it doesn't always work. I was really struggling this morning when I was cooking Marnie's fish, wondering myself whether I could or should even attempt the walk to the corner to get the Radio Times. I enjoy this mini ritual, so I did some stretches and eventually managed to hobble my way to the newsagent. They only get a few copies, and today I told myself I might cry if it wasn't there, but it was. Hooray! And I leaned on the counter, crossed the newspapers to count my change. The guys who run the store are Pakistani, and we're really good friends, so we were sharing words when I heard the voice say, "Excuse me." I thought they wanted to get by, so it's kind of narrow there, so I squeezed into the counter when I heard it again. As I looked up, a really good-looking but totally irate black man, dark blue sweater, very trim, tasteful gold chain, grabbed his copy of the crap paper with such a vengeance that I was a bit taken back. It was only 7:45 and already such a temper. As he went round me to pay, he had to wait again, and I said the wrong thing. Well, truly, anything would have been the wrong thing. Patience, I said. It's a really small shop, so we're all jammed in together, but I had the escape route by the door. Patience, he screams. You should learn patience, you fucker. And you should learn posture. I'm actually an incredibly patient person. Nothing in my life has come to me quickly. And I enjoy the chilled approach. But posture, he could call me fucker till his balls dropped off. And he did, and they probably did as well. Now, if I decided to crank up, like in the old days, when my unruly temper was in the driver's seat, let's just say I could take him and he would be shocked. But he attacked my poor, aching, somewhat slouchy body, and that needed defending. I was paralyzed as a child, I said. Somewhat lame in retrospect, but the truth, and all I had at the time. The sweet Pakistani guy behind the counter was so upset as he faced me, feeling unable to do anything. And the few people in line were clearly shocked, but no one was going to quieten this guy. I thought it odd that he didn't call me a bitch, that all his you fuckers and stuff were so incredibly masculine. Kindness, I said, as he passed me on his way to the door. Just be kind. He loved that. Clearly, it made a huge impression. You this, you that, he screamed as we exited the shop. Smile, I told him, as he walked away in a hurry to spread the joy. I think I got him. Have a nice day, you fucker, he shouted. People always comment on how much stuff happens to me in the early hours of the day. All that, and it's only 9 o'clock, they say. I get to lie down now and read the TV guide with a hot water bottle on the hip that caused my posture to so offend the irate, nice-looking man. I wasn't upset. Actually, it was so extreme, it was kind of funny. This calmness and kindness thing really works, but truth be told, I do often wish I could stand a bit straighter. I knew everyone. I knew Hendrix. I knew Neil Young. I'm not saying well, okay? Jim Morrison, I knew all throughout his career to the end of his life. We had a
extremely intimate and loving relationship.
And I would say, Robbie Burns was a poet. You're a fucking rock star.
I lived with Frank. You know, Alice Cooper was around, Taj Mahal was around.
If you look back at like Pam's life or my life, there's about a 5-year period where so much shit happens that is kind of big time that it's actually stunning when you think about it. Because I go through like decades now where like nothing very interesting happens. People that are on classic acts now are like our everyday buddies. And it wasn't important at the time. When you look back now, like people look at you like, wow, you have all these great stories with all these interesting people. And they were just like right next to nobodies at the time. It's kind of funny when you think about it.
One night we, a bunch of young guys our own age were crashing and they had sleeping bags on the floor. And we were there and like just grateful to have a roof over our heads. I'm not saying we didn't do it for years, but we did it for a while, long enough. One night in the street's a long time. And so we were just about to go to sleep. It's like 3 o'clock in the morning. And one of these bodies says to one of the other bodies, does anyone want some acid? And I like, hopped up. I looked at Julia in the middle of the night and I go, what kind of a place are we in? They're gonna burn each other with acid. That can't be fun.
Hi.
Hello. Here? Hello, Julia.
Hello.
Hi. The first night we went to Hollywood, we went to Phil Spector's
it's
house.
It's all your fault.
You know how Pam is kind of blasé? It's like the King of England could be standing there and she'd go, whatever, you know. And that was day one, within hours of hitting the Sunset Strip. We were actually good road dogs because we never liked the same people. Never. It would never happen. You know, I wanted the cute, blonde, tall drummer from the Birds, and she wanted fucking Phil Spector. What are you going to do with that, you know? Think about it. You and I are from the same, not generation, because we probably knew people that it was about hot casual sex. Because I would almost guarantee that none of the sex I ever had in those days was hot.
How about casual?
You know, it isn't like now where, like, someone in their 20s might actually interact with their parents on some level. They were from a different time, and her father was, like, bad news, and she knew my mother was bad news. So, I mean, we only used them occasionally for showers or moccasin insoles. There was no reason to talk to them other than that. All parents were scum at that point in time. We were counterculture, don't forget. There was an actual culture that we were countering. Well, we didn't really do drugs. We do like some coke. I mean, John and all those guys, maybe they had their acid days in early college years or something, but I never knew any of the Doors, including Jim, to be hard drug users at all. You know, I had a house and an organic vegetable garden and cats and, you know, a dog. And that was about the time I made the decision that I should probably go with John. You know, it's like, Greg John. You know, Greg was a real coyote. John was a meditating, you know, vegetarian. It was like, he was just a funny guy, Jim, to me, you know. You know, that he had had this whole interlude with Pam that I was not involved with was so bizarre.
I met him at a party, and he was, like, really dirty, and no one wanted to speak to him, and he was telling these really outrageous lies, and once again, it was like love at first sight. And I felt
this, by the way, is the only tall, good-looking boyfriend of yours that I can think of.
He wasn't that tall.
He, you know, everything she says is true. I have maybe slightly different memories of stuff. But like I said, we were like on these parallel tracks. So like Puerto Rico is a good example. Wait, here. This is outside. See my pool? Don't you wish you were here? People go, don't you want to go see the Allman Brothers? Like, I would rather give myself a root canal than stand through another 3-hour, extravaganza of guitar blues, you know, like on the side of the stage while my bunions hurt. It's different when you're older. I don't believe in tough love.
Thank you so much.
Talk to you later.
When things really began to happen was after Puerto Rico. The Puerto Rico Festival took place on the night of the full moon, took place over several nights of full moon. And I had a long and ongoing relationship with the guys from Alice Cooper. I ended up with Glenn, who's a really, really lovely guy, the guitar player. And I remember the journey down there. I had a couple of stops, and I'd get off the airplane, stand at the bar, and just drink as many Bloody Marys as I could possibly get into my body and still be able to walk back onto that plane.
I have been in hell. That it may have been of my own making makes no difference. I have definitely spent time there, wallowed around lost and defiant, experienced its gray murkiness. Arguably, they sent me one of their emissaries in the role of my father.
I loved smoking marijuana.
I never stopped. I didn't stop when everyone I knew stopped. I didn't stop from morning till night, from sun up till sunset. Whenever I was awake, I was busy getting high, trying to get high, chasing that elusive feeling I had the first time I ever smoked, when the ice cream tasted so incredible and the sidewalk curbs were 2 foot high and everything looked like Disneyland. Knowing I would never be there again, on I went telling myself it made things more fun, made me happier, more relaxed. Not what my loved ones had been telling me all those years. I excelled as I had once with alcohol. No one could smoke or drink more than me, as I had once been able to drink all the serious drinkers under the table. I could just switch on and keep going, and that is what I did for many, many years. It was when I began to realize I was a healer that I knew something had to change. Though I know many good healers who continue to smoke, I knew it wouldn't work for me. I figured Spirit had chosen me to do the work and wanted to provide them with as pure a channel as possible, and I began to change. We used to take THC back then. It was a pill. It was kind of like a really good marijuana high. Nobody knows what it was. It was supposed to be fake marijuana, blah, blah, blah. It was probably some animal tranquilizer, as most of these things were. So there's a bit of that going around. So I had a few of those. Yeah, I was stoned, but like I was always stoned. I was always stoned and I was always drunk. That was my natural state. I was a little bit high. And we get in the car and we go to the festival. And for some reason, I'm in the car with Cindy Lang and the guys are on stage, going towards the stage. We get out of the car and it's really, really deep mud everywhere. And there's the full moon in the sky. It's quite a magical evening. When all of a sudden, I look up and there's this giant sun, and it's coming towards us. And it's making this noise like womp, womp, womp. And all of a sudden, Cindy Lang and I lifted up somewhere else, another dimension, another level.
From where we were, we could see the stage down below. And for a while, we could see our bodies leaning on the back of this car. So there we are with these other energies, spirit-like energies, one could say God-like energies. And I'm like, okay. Wasn't frightening, it just was. You know, I was always very matter of fact. Clearly we've been brought there to be given certain messages. And it's made very apparent to me that they had to take me in my somewhat inebriated state to talk to me. They wanted to share with me what it was about. And the thing that I took away from it the most was that it was supposed to be fun. Music is everything. It's everything. Even I knew that. But they wanted me to know that it's supposed to be fun. I did know from that moment that my life had changed forever, that it would never be the same, that I would never lead the same life, that everything would change. And it did. Quit my job, never done anything conventional ever since. Because that fun and that lightness that they were talking about, that's here for us. That could be our reality. And not this sadness and darkness and heaviness, this oppression. Music is everything. It's the bridge between. It's the expression of the soul. I hear from them from time to time. Many of them. Not all the time. From time to time. Frank, you know, he's often wearing a beret or some sort of hat. And we might just be laughing about what our relationship was like when he was here. Or he might be thinking about the illness that took him away from us at such a tender young age. So I know is that they process on the other side. It can take a really long time. There's sense of time, you know, when you're in spirit, when you're on the other side, when you're gone, when you're passed away, dead, whatever the fuck you want to call it. You know, I always say there is no death, and believe me, I know there isn't, because you wake up and find hands on you in the night giving you healing or something. There's definitely something else going on. I've been very fortunate to see them, to hear them, to be able to touch them, feel them, smell them. It's real. I could be asleep, but I would know I'm asleep. But I've been awake on many, many, many occasions. You know, you feel the weight of the body. And I would say with certain people, they come at certain times. You know, Frank has often come at times when I was feeling really low, just to bring me a bit of love or a hug. But they often come because there's something that they're thinking about that they want to talk about. Maybe something they think on earth that they didn't do well enough. Perhaps
they were too involved in their own career. And that might have made it hard on their family. I'm not into giving them a hard time. Never mind, baby, it's all good. It goes on. If you think you're leaving here and you're not taking it with you, you're making a big mistake. So clean up your shit now. Wake up. Start talking to your fellows. Your fellows, mans and women. Not envying them. Not comparing yourself to them. Because you're taking it with you. You can tell them to go, dear. You don't have to let them hang around.
Dead. They're not even ghosts. Their presence is felt so strongly every day. We miss their physical presence. And that's why I'm telling these stories. People always tell me you have to tell these stories, their history. And even though their behavior was certainly not always honorable and often quite questionable, it's by telling these tales that I seek to honor them.
We all did applaud when he told us the tale.
No story about the 60s could be complete without mention of Howard Roland Parker, H as he was lovingly known, right here in the middle of Portobello, his home. And I would say that if I was the woman behind the man, in terms of the music world, he was definitely the man behind the man. You know, people might say, oh, he was a roadie or whatever. He was so many things. He had this massive record collection, lived very modestly. And he was well known for standing behind the Marshall amps when Jimmy shagged them.
To have to stand behind the columns, holding it up, whilst he fucked it around the front.
Howard stood firm, for it all might come down. And we all did applaud when he told us the tale. So I'd come to London, I was much faded, don't ask me why, but I was. And I was all the A-list parties and OPAMs in town, blah, 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 blah. You know, probably because of the Frank Zappa connection, whatever. And there was the Ozzy Clarks and the David Hockneys, and I was like, England, an interesting place. And there was the premiere of the Hendrix film that Joe Boyd and John Head and, yes, Gary Wise had made. And so we're a big, big, fated premiere in the middle of Leicester Square, blah, blah, blah. And we're all there, and there are all these talking heads, you know. I think Pete Townsend was in it, and Mick was definitely in it. When Howard Parker came on the screen, that cinema erupted in applause. This man was so loved. Truly, you know. And so he had worked for Mark Bolan at the time, you know. He worked for Tony Howard, he worked for Steve O'Rourke, who managed the Pink Floyd, you know. Hello, baby. Mark comes off stage looking a bit like this kitty and hands Howard his guitar and says, this is yours, Howard, to keep. And H was just stunned. He just was like, oh my God. You know, it was a Gibson Les Paul. So we come home, he's so excited. Drops us off.
calls me the next day. In the morning, he realized it was a Japanese fake. So eventually, when Dingwalls opened, it was a big deal. It was the music club in London at the time. It really, really was exceptional. I got one of the first members' cards, thanks to my friend, Mr. Parker. And he was the musical director. And musical, he did direct, because they had the Average White Band. Elvis Costello played his first gig there. Blondie played their first gig there. You know, it was the place. It truly was. We used to ride around. He had a big old car, his big old blue car. I don't know, maybe a Ford Zephyr or something. It was a big old boat of a car. Kind of very reminiscent of him. And we used to ride around in this car late at night. Hello, hello, can you come and get in the film? Hello, come here, come here. Hello, hello. Hello, doggy. Hello, kitty. Bye, Bella. Bye. Come on, Pusscat. So he had this big old boat of a car. I think it was like Navy or something. It was kind of like his flat, except it didn't have the records inside. I think, you know, he was probably one of the first DJs, as it were. He loved it. He loved the music like I did, you know. There's some people that's just in them. They just know what it means. And we used to ride around his car like late at night smoking joints. And I remember the last night, you know, we rode around and he'd been doing some therapy or something. And he was a bit despondent and like, what's it all for? I'm like, come on, H, you know how loved you are. But it was his message to me, I'm certain. So I used to go to Greece and stay at a friend's house. And he had like a little sailboat that he like used to repair himself. And he went off to Greece, and apparently he was having lunch with some people. And he had sailed down in his little boat, and they finished lunch and they watched him sail away, and he never came back. His disappearance caused a major, major rift in the hierarchy of the social scene of London. So they had this party at Dingwalls, and they put his name on the thing and they hadn't spelled his name correctly. And I was told that I better appear, and if I didn't put in an appearance, that I would be paying for it socially for the rest of my time in London. And I was determined not to appear. It didn't feel right to me. And I did pay for it socially, ostracized for only the next 15 or 20 years. But I remained true to him in my heart. And as the song says, Howard sailed to a North African shore where folks took to a stranger with sand-colored hair, thoughts vaguely recalled and then put to one side. There's nets to repair and fresh fish to be fried. For you, H, with love from us all.
Thank you.
catnip. Started with a white English bull terrier called Lou Grant, who was much loved and revered.
We loved animals. We loved them.
And one day, we went walking. It was after Chernobyl, and that was the end. He had these huge sores, and they used to open up on his body. And one day I woke up and I thought, he needs healing. I didn't know what healing was. You know, when I was, right before my mom died, we had just a small bit of land. My mom took me outside and all the stuff was growing, you know, oranges, everything. She grew organic even then, and, you know, free range chickens and all I really cared about then was like getting away, drinking, distancing myself. I just turned 16. And my mom just says, just stop for a minute. Just look around you. Just look around you. Because one day you're going to realize that you have everything you will ever need. Right here. I carried that with me for a really long time, right here to this space. Perhaps, who knows, maybe a little portal to the other side, who knows. Sometimes people come and they say, it looks like heaven. That's a nice thing to hear. The ruler is here.
Marnie, the keeper of the flame.
We're here. We're in the flesh. Yes, I bleed. But we are so much more. You know, this is energy. We need to connect with our source and move forward. You know. We've come to make it extraordinary. You know, you think about it. How the smallest thing, you know. One morning, everyone on the planet woke up and decided to be kind to everyone else. It's all over. I like to think that's where we're headed. You know, happiness is a choice.
because you look like a pop star. And fix him up. Mod jacket. Really mod neck piece. Jimi Hendrix wig. And the belly boa.
It was the ride of a lifetime. We arrived at the Royal Gardens. Frank was so excited. So they had this amazing dessert we'd never heard of in America called a peach melba. Wowza. I remember that day we went to the some antique type market, well-known market, and there it was, the famous Zappa Crappa. No one had seen it before, the photograph, poster of him sitting on the toilet. Herbie was really upset because he hadn't had his piece of the action. Apparently, it was the hottest ticket in town, but we didn't know that at the time. We didn't know much of anything, you know. He knew they liked him in England, and we had agreed that I would come along because they were so hairy and scary and not hippie-like at all. No one knew what to make of them. And I was the normal one, and the spokesperson to some extent on political matters. So speaking of scary, we went to the Marquee one night. I think Jeff Beck was taking us around a lot. I remember it well because we were in the car and he stopped and he said to someone, "Cheery bye," and Frank was like, "What? What is this country?" Amongst the crowd, Pete Townsend came up and introduced himself to Frank. And behind him was Keith Moon, who sort of snuck up, had a really good look, and then ran away. We also did the Roundhouse. It was packed at the time. We're downstairs. Frank is just surrounded. I'm standing next to him. Long-haired, spaced-out dude comes up, hands him something. Frank puts his hand out, puts a piece of hashish in his hand. Good-sized piece, too. Frank's like, "What is it?" And I'm like, "Frank, just give it back." He's like, "What is it?" And I'm like, "Listen, Frank, it's not anything you want." So eventually he gave it back. God, they were really upset. They were really, really upset because it was true. He didn't use drugs. But the night came. I remember being, a little apprehensive in the hotel room before we went. So I downed a lot of whiskey. And then we go out on stage. And I'll tell you, I sobered up really fast. We step out on stage. And the audience is all around you, 350 degrees. It's like, yeah. Felt really at home. And Frank's introducing the group, Jimmy Carl Black, who always called me Susie fucking Cream Cheese. You know, the only real brother I've ever had.
You're the most disgusting thing I've ever seen in my life.
So he goes, "Okay, and now the member of our group whose hair is longest in the back, Susie Cream Cheese." And the audience is like, I think I got the most applause, and I'm sure that didn't go down very well. Like, you feel that audience, you feel their warmth and their love. And their receptivity. And they were giving me all of that, as well as the guys, even though in no way was it for me. But I knew in that moment what it was like to be on that stage, surrounded by all of that adoration. And I knew in that moment how that could change lives overnight. And in fact, it did. For me, it was just like being in your living room full of friends until we came off stage.
So I'm holding this bouquet of flowers, and we're suddenly surrounded, and we're surrounded by this person and that person and all these adoring people. And that's when this, you know, Stevie Winwood's people came up, and they're like, oh, he really wants you to come to this party he's having. And we were like, we were leaving at 6 o'clock in the morning. Even then, Herbie, you couldn't plan a tour so it could be fun. It was kind of the end, and I was just standing on the stage by myself with my little baby in here, just starting to show, when Jimmy arrived, carrying the most amazing bunch of asparagus I have ever seen. They were big, fat, and looked quite delicious. And trust me, in those days, you couldn't get asparagus in England. We're standing together, him here, me here, and he's holding this asparagus with both hands, like this, leaning it against my pregnant belly. We're both looking down at the asparagus and looking up at each other. A moment in time. He's like, okay, you coming with me? And I'm like, nah, I gotta go home.
Hey, can we just have one more time? Wait, we saw the film there. Stop it for a second.
You know, Jimmy was just a nice guy, and had enough women who wanted to shag him, and there's always this thing of, oh, you didn't do anything, and I don't know why you were even there, and you weren't even there, and just because you believed in me when no one on the planet believed in me, and you were my friend when no one wanted to know me, and no one wanted to shag me, and no one wanted to employ me, and you thought I was brilliant and fantastic, and you were there behind me, I mean, what does that mean? And I would have to say that that has run through every single one of them that I have known or encountered. You know, you hit that stage, you stand under the limelight, and the person you once were is no longer. Except for Jimmy. You know, they say life is perfect. Everything arrives in its own good time. I'm looking back now, and it's 45 years or 45 minutes ago, depending on your perspective. Trust me, it's all good.
I feel that I've always been a healer. When I was younger, people would always comment on the touch of my hands. It made them feel serene and relaxed. I was surrounded by a great deal of energy that I wasn't sure how to channel. I'm a great lover of the animal kingdom and have always had an interest in veterinary medicine in particular. But this had broadened into an interest in acquired knowledge of herbs and homeopathy. I helped people at their request who have already been diagnosed and had a keen interest in helping themselves. In 1987, I had a much-loved animal who fell desperately ill. All the conventional methods were incapable of eliciting a cure. I became convinced that he needed healing. Within days, I made contact with Nikki, who came to visit Lugie and was able, through her own work and the input of Kathleen Hughes and the spirit doctors, to unravel the mystery of Lugie's illness. He was basically allergic to the planet and eventually crossed over after long and debilitating illness. He was much loved on the planet, and many doctors, including herbalists, homeopaths, and more conventional schools, band together to try and help him. When I first saw Nikki giving him healing, I realized what I had been doing all my life. After observing her with Lugie, myself, and other family members, I began to practice.
Thank you.
little boy, not yet 10. My mother is a frustrated and volatile alcoholic. TV is my refuge. I'm sitting under the dining room table, my eyes glued to the screen, the night she goes upstairs and drowns in the bath. My brothers come in and ask accusingly how long has she been upstairs before breaking down the bathroom door. I'm watching a cowboy film. I've carried this guilt all my life.
There was no way Trigger was going to put a hoof on me. No way. After what we'd been through together.
So I'm laying on a trolley. I'm in the hallway. And my parents are there. And obviously I was quite concussed and I'm just kind of like nodding out. And this nurse comes up and takes my pulse. And quite clearly was certain that I was dead and pulls the fucking sheet up over my head. And I'm like, wait a minute, what is it with these adults expecting me to be dead all the time? I'm supposed to be born dead. Now I'm dead. Maybe I didn't have a pulse. Who knows? So they take me in the x-ray room and I'm there and I'm just lying there just like flat out. And then I hear this voice, my dad in this one moment in his life, and he's like praying or something, and he's like, oh, please be okay. Please be okay. You know, if you wake up, if you're okay, I'll buy you any horse you want. And I'm like, wait a minute. So I wait until he repeats it about three times, and I'm like, I sit up and go, I want a Palomino. He berated me for fooling him, but on this occasion, so pleased was he to see me alive, he actually kept his word. Her name was Queen, and she had belonged to Clara Bow, star of The Silent Screen. Mr. Stately really thought Clara Bow was the bee's knees. She cost $300, and she really didn't want to go into that trailer. She did tricks, like she would rear up or kneel down if you asked her, and she was very beautiful in a Morgan sort of way. Stocky, not too tall, very long mane and tail. I never felt that she liked me. It was strange because I loved animals so much, but I now realize animals have baggage, and I'm certain Queenie had a lot. Mr. Stately put me on her and told me to hang on tight, a rope around her neck for safety. We galloped around the ring, Queenie bucking and twisting, not having been ridden in a long time, me holding on for dear life, well frightened. It wasn't supposed to be like this. I blame myself to this day for her unhappiness. And I tell you this story in the hopes that you might see the futility of doing the same. The things that transpired in Queenie's life were beyond my control. I was only 12 years old, but the idea of what I perceived as her suffering haunts me at times, even though I often see her in my dreams and she is well and happy. It was a very hard time in my own life, the time leading up to my mother's death, and I was young and ignorant, though obviously very sensitive. The decision to breed Queenie was not mine. It was possible she was too old for this undertaking. And when she did become pregnant, it was with twins. One day I rode her too hard, though as I look back now, even this is debatable. She was barn sour. She wouldn't venture with great ease far from home, and she stopped running when she wanted to. I was very upset myself that day, and I forgot to cool her down. I didn't understand that she needed special care in her condition. No one had explained it to me, and I got in much trouble for my actions. That night, the vet was called, and on examining her, told us she wasn't pregnant at all. The next morning, she gave birth to twins, stillborn. I will never forget the look in her eyes as she circled her poor, lifeless babies. I looked after her as best I could afterwards, but it never could have been enough. It was understood that it was my fault, what had happened to her. And though I'm able to look now at myself in a compassionate light, knowing that I was young and innocent, and that the real decisions in Queenie's life were in fact made by adults who were careless in their lack of information, and possibly their judgment calls as well, still the idea that I may have ever in some way contributed to her unhappiness is just too much to bear. Queenie recovered very quickly. We moved to a new place where she lived an extremely cosseted life in a wonderful environment until my mother was killed and everything changed. She had to be sold. And I remember how great she looked prancing around the ring in auction, and that she was bought as a rental horse where she would have been well looked after and done as she damn well pleased. Her fate and her happiness were out of my hands, and I felt terrible at having to let her go. Everyone I know has an animal story, if not as dramatic, something of this nature. With Jules, it was those ducks. Just too much enthusiasm in the herding. And again with myself, the time I fed our chinchilla too many raisins and he keeled over from literally too much pleasure. That he had lived a lonely and miserable existence, kept on his own without a partner and not even in the house with us for company, was not the point. The point was that once again, out of the ignorance of childhood, I had committed a foul deed. No one told me not to feed him so many of the raisins he so dearly loved. When my time comes, I would love to go from eating too many of my favorite things. And I know that I should and do periodically let it go as I ask you to do. You love them and you do your best. Sometimes you find out better, and when you know better, you do better. I am sure that Queenie and our chinchilla forgave me, if in fact I needed forgiving, long before my family ever did, light years before I was truly able to forgive myself.
Be not so sorry for what you've done. You must forget them now, it's done. When you wake up, you'll find that you can run. Be not so sorry for what you've done. Be not so sorry for what you've done.
So not long after we first met, you called me up, I think, on the phone and said, why don't you come over? I want to tell you a story. Which turned out to be your story, and we went into your living room and you lay on the bed and you made sure I was comfortable on a chair, possibly with a blanket, possibly with a hot water bottle, which are often supplied. And you went on to tell me the story, which was your story. I think I lived with feelings of guilt for a long time.
I always knew from the time that I was a child that my father was going to kill my mother one day. It's just some things you just know. And my father was crazy, and he had it in him. It didn't happen all the time. But when it did happen, it was very ugly, and there would be like fists to the head, and guns would come out. And
he's gonna bump you up, yeah. He's got a gun, you know. If he didn't get you in Laurel Canyon, he won't get you here.
Hello?
Vicky?
Yeah?
What's happening?
Listen, your father has called me up.
Now look, just don't panic, but just tell me. Okay.
I think my phone's tapped too.
Well, don't worry about it. It's quite all right.
All right.
So, the night before my mother died, I came home from school, and my mother wasn't there. My dad was there. He didn't live with us at the time. He would come down on the weekends, and he was there, and he said they'd had this really big fight, and she'd run away, and his glasses were broken, and da da da. And I'd had enough. I had had enough. I knew where it was going. I knew I wasn't going to be able to prevent it. And I had discovered alcohol by that time, which really was my salvation. And I was determined that I was going out to the dance that night to get well and truly loaded, as I had just discovered doing. So my father went away, my mother eventually, I found my mother, she came back. And the writing was pretty much on the wall. But I just was determined I was going out, and she agreed to drive me to the dance. But she, by that time, she knew what I'd been getting up to, and she was very determined that I was going to stay at that dance. So she dropped me off, and I saw her drive around the block a few times, and till I knew it was cool to leave and go and get drunk and then come back. I had a friend call to make sure she was at home, and she was. And when I came home late that night, well and truly pissed, I noticed that her door was closed. And the dog that she always kept with her, Petty, who was a German shepherd who had very large feet, was not in her room with her, he was outside. And when I woke up in the morning, my friend was there too with a terrible hangover. It was about 8 o'clock. She hadn't been up. And she always woke up about 5 o'clock in order to feed the horses and get the place running. And then I noticed again that her door was closed. And I noticed again that Petty was outside. And I knew, so I went round the outside of the house to her window. I went to open the door, it didn't open. I knocked on the window, no answer, no answer. And eventually I was conflicted. I didn't want her to be angry at me if I'd waken her up, but I just knew. And we went around the side and I broke the bathroom window and I went inside and I found her. Not yet expired, but well on the way. Came back, called the ambulance. The ambulance took a really long time getting there. They wound around up the hill. They got lost getting there. So finally, I got her in the ambulance and sent her off to hospital. And when that happens, you think, oh, they're going to be fine. They're in the ambulance now. They're going to sort it all out. And I was at home, and I was smoking a cigarette, and my dad showed up. And he just showed up out of nowhere, and he came in and he went, what's happened to your mother? And I was like, what do you mean? He's like, I know something's happened. What's happened to your mother? I said, nothing's happened to my mother. She's fine. Then I saw that look come over his face. So I knew I had to tell him she was in the hospital. But the night before, she had driven me to collect my friend on the way to the dance. While we were driving, she asked me questions. She said, do you love Petty? This is her much beloved German shepherd. And I go, what do you mean? She goes, do you love Petty? And I said, of course I do. You know I love him. And she said, will you take care of him when I'm gone? And I just said, yeah, yeah, of course I'll take care of him. I knew what she meant. I knew. But I was going to that dance. And arguably, had I paid more attention to what she was telling me? Had I made a different decision? What happened that night could have been avoided. I would have been home, and it wouldn't have happened. And I knew that after the event. I was young, and I knew that I had made a choice. And I knew that I had a choice to carry that guilt for the rest of my life, or to see it for what it was, and know that I might have prevented something briefly. But I was young, I was not that empowered. I might have stayed and died myself. Guilt. We carry it around like a ball and chain inside on our heart. It only exists for one reason. It exists so that we can look at our behavior and modify it. We're not meant to be carrying it like such a burden, day in and day out, and destroying our own lives. It's simple. It doesn't need to be expensive. It doesn't need to be involved. It doesn't need to be intellectual. You just allow the flow. You allow things to happen. You know, if you're like, when you're rushing, you got your list and everything, how are you, the synchronicity of the day, you know, the saying, stop and smell the flowers, please. That's why we're here. It's supposed to be fun. You're supposed to enjoy it. We're supposed to laugh. There's supposed to be love. We're supposed to listen to music, and we're supposed to get together and make it better all the time. That's why we're here.
Round like a circle in a spiral, like a wheel within a wheel, never ending or beginning on a never spinning reel, like a snowball down a mountain or a carnival balloon, like a carousel that's turning, running rings around the moon, like a clock whose hands are sweeping past the minutes of its face, and the world is like an apple whirling silently in space, like the circles that you find in the windmills of your mind, like a tunnel that you follow to a tunnel of its own, down a hollow to a cavern where the sun has never shone, like a door that keeps revolving in a half-forgotten dream, or the ripples from a pebble someone tosses in a stream, like a clock whose hands are sweeping past the minutes of its face, and the world is like an apple whirling silently in space, like the circles that you find in the windmills of your mind. Keys that jingle in your pocket, words that jangle in your head. Why did summer go so quickly? Was it something that you said? Lovers walk along the shore and leave their footprints in the sand. Is the sound of distant drumming just the fingers of your hand? Pictures hanging in a hallway and the fragment of a song. Half-remembered names and faces, but to whom do they belong? When you knew that it was over, you were suddenly aware that the autumn leaves were turning to the color of her hair. A circle in a spiral, a wheel within a wheel, never ending or beginning on an ever-spinning reel, as the images unwind like the circles that you find in the windmills of your mind.